I'd like to welcome you all to the India's first ever women conference. I would like to greet Senior Advocate Mahalakshmi Pawani ma'am and our chief guest Flavia Agnes ma'am. We all welcome you and we all thank you for joining us in the medium of internet. As I told earlier that we are supposed to do this as a physical conference, but COVID has changed a lot of things. So thank you so much. So first we'd like to discuss about how why I think this WomenX conference is important. The first thing is that I would like to request my team to share the PPT that Pragya was supposed to present. Please, Kundan. So there are some few things which I observed that the discussion or the debate around us, which are going to take place, is a lot minor these days. And I noticed some of the speakers, and I must appreciate Pallavi Parikh ma'am, who has by time and again has pointed this issue on social media and other platform, is that the participation of women speaker as a speaker is very limited even in these days, and which is I think is very problematic. So these are some few glimpses that we are sharing right now, is that how the discussion around any issue is not balanced. So thank you so much, and respected panelists, chief guest Flavia Agnes ma'am, who all joined us. I would like to I'd like to present our work as an organization, Socio Legal Literary, is a student run venture established in February 2020 with the aim for an egalitarian society and an academic excellence in law, literature and policy science. Since the inception, SLL has been instrumental in setting the right discourse, be it SLL conceptually conducted a series of interviews, namely transmission, to ensure the voice of trans community is heard to the mainstream society. In the series of People's Issue called Lok Ki Baat, we set the discourse on Indian nationalism, rise of a majoritarian regime, violations of human rights, career and employment opportunity for students. We have also conducted discussions, projects, and this course, which is not only contributed to the academia, but also set a social standard, which a constitutional democracy pleased to its citizens, and Sam Sambad 2020 is one such example. Our flagship series, Samvidhan Sambad with Tarunav Khetan, in collaboration with Live Law, co-hosted by me and law researcher columnist Surbhi Karwa, Professor Tarunav Khetan, Oxford University, Wadham College, aims to fill the gap on constitutional engagement of people with the text in constitution. Under the aegis of Project Aap Ki Bhasa, SLL has assisted the Criminal Law Reform Awareness Project, a project by Professor Aru Sigal from Sheffield School of Law, United Kingdom, to translate into 9 regional languages with the aim to spread awareness. Be at SLL brings you this unique dialogue with the aim of inclusivity and a contribution in egalitarian society. Before I would invite our chief guest to address us, I must say the panelists and guests who are gracing us with their divinest presence is an inspiration in our journey as an organization of students who witness their contribution to the society at large. Our chief guest, Flavia Agnes ma'am, is a women's rights lawyer, scholar par excellence. Her widely published writings have provided a vital context for feminist respondents, not only in India, but also abroad. Her autobiographical essay on domestic violence titled My Story, Our Story, Rewilding Broken Lives, is an important marker of the Indian women's movement and also translated into several languages. She is also a founder of Majlis and National Film Award winner for the best film on social issues. I am very grateful to the Mahalakshmi Pawani ma'am who graced us as a distinguished speaker, Pallavi Parikh ma'am, founder Ungender, who also is a distinguished guest, Devolina Saha ma'am, founder Intensive Bank, who also joined us as a distinguished guest and later as a panelist in other theme. Now I would like to give the mic to the Flavia Agnes ma'am to address as a keynote speaker.
So thank you very much for inviting me here and to asking me to deliver this inaugural lecture. I am very happy that you all are doing this work in the midst of this pandemonium where everybody is in a lockdown mode, so that students can utilize this time and get exposed to various ideas. So I think it's a brilliant idea, and I welcome the opportunity to be able to speak to you. I'll just tell a few sentences about myself. In fact, I was asking Rajesh why you chose me and what should be the topic. And he told me that I should speak about the women's movement in India, how it progressed, etc. And a panel discussion will speak about the specific issues that are highlighted in their session. So let me go to the beginning. According to me, two kinds of beginnings are there for the Indian women's movement. The impetus that was given. One was the Status of Women report, which was presented at the United Nations in 1975 for the International Year of the Women. So this report brought out the actual pitiable state in which Indian women are sort of trapped, that since independence there has not been much progress, but in fact the trends have been reversed. The number of women had dropped, number of work participation percentage had dropped, literacy rates had improved but only marginally. So there were a lot of issues, the poverty had increased, women headed households, a new category emerged, and all this required special attention from our government. So at the UN level, it was declared to announce a international decade of women rather than a year of women. So 1975 to 85, there was the international decade for women, and various countries introduced several programs. There was a conference at 1985, but in between there was a conference in Mexico, mid-decade conference. And after 10 years of the conference ended, 1995, there was another UN conference in Beijing. So there has been a lot of focus on the status of women. And more specifically, there are certain UN conventions, declarations, etc., which address the issue globally of giving higher status to women. So you can say this is one impetus, and we got CEDAW was passed, women's rights as a human rights slogan was given. So this is at the UN level, in the national level. But if we see at the practical level in India, in 1980, in fact, there was a big campaign about women's rights revolving around violence against women. And from that period started the entire 2-3 decades where issues were addressed to bring in law reforms to take care of the problem. This 1980 movement, in fact, gave a blueprint that how women's issues need to be addressed. They need to have a legal solution, and there should be laws to address them. In this context, I want to speak about the Mathura rape case, which became a catalyst for the movement. And I don't know how many of you know about this case, the details of this. If not, I can just briefly go through that. This case happened in Maharashtra, in a rural tribal village, where a girl between 15 and 16 was called to the police station. And while she was there, she was raped and molested by two policemen on duty. Very strange thing about this case is that when her people found her missing and approached the police station, initially police station has left. And after that, she herself came out, her hair all disheveled, and she told her relatives that she had been raped. Mind you, this girl was an orphan. She was an illiterate girl. She was working as a maidservant in somebody's house, and she was induced into elopement. Well, she didn't have an agency. She was so young, and she had nobody, no support. She was induced into elopement by the madam's brother, and she had gone with him. And her brother filed a case in the police station, and she was caught. This happened in 1972. So there was not a visible women's movement or anything. But surprisingly, that night itself, the village came out into her support and pressurized the police to file a case. So the rape case was registered, and it proceeded. Investigation happened. The policemen were belonging to the same police station where investigations were taking place. So there are a lot of these different pulls in this case. I will not go into detail about each of them, but important thing is that when the case went up to trial, the Sessions Court declared that since there were no marks of injury on her body, it cannot be construed as rape. This is a voluntary case of voluntary sexual relationship, and she has, since she has consented to that, there is no rape. The policemen were acquitted. Some women's groups in Nagpur and that side, Vidarbha, Nagpur, took up this issue, pressurized the state to file an appeal against acquittal. And the case came to the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court. The High Court verdict came in 1974, and the High Court reversed the Sessions Court verdict and said that a quiet acquiescence is not rape. For it to be the quiet acquiescence is rape. It's not consent. To be the consent means a free and voluntary consent, and it has to be given without fear, without any pressure. So the fact that the policeman had accosted this girl inside the police station when she was alone, you cannot call this consent, so it amounts to rape. The policemen were convicted. 1978, the Supreme Court verdict came. Three judges of the Supreme Court reversed the High Court judgment, upheld the Sessions Court judgment, which has said she's a liar, she has made up this whole story, there are no marks of injury, etc. And acquitted the policeman. Certain human rights organizations, civil liberty groups, etc., were shocked and opposed this judgment. They wrote against it. They asked for a review. Particularly among them was Professor Upendra Bakshi, who was at the Indian Law Institute at the time. And he wrote a letter, and three other law teachers supported him. They endorsed this letter, and it was sent to the Chief Justice. And in that letter, it was stated that if this judgment is allowed to remain in our statute books, it will snuff out the hopes of millions of Mathuras. Because Mathura's situation was so grave, there was no opportunity to say that she had consented. She was called to the police station. She was called for interrogation. Night came, she was kept waiting there, etc. And she was so vulnerable. She didn't have parents. She was very poor. She was illiterate. She could not have manipulated the system at all. And yet the judges of the Supreme Court did not believe her. So you can imagine how they would view any other women. So every woman who was active in various other movements, trade union movements, civil liberty movements, etc., perceived it as a personal injury. The Supreme Court had said something about them personally or about their daughters. So they came together as women across party lines, across their other affiliations, etc., as women. And they held demonstrations in various cities. It was long before the Nirbhaya case, as you can see, 1980. And then they approached the government. They asked for a review. They approached the Supreme Court. They asked for a review of this case, etc. March 8, 1980 was declared as International Women's Day. And for the first time, it was celebrated by all these groups. And they raised the issue of reform of rape law. Then government suddenly woke up, and then they said, yes, we must reform the rape law. They formed a law parliamentary committee. Law commission made its recommendations. Various things happened. In 1983, we got the criminal law on rape was amended. And we got after many, many years, we got a first law reform on the issue of rape. Now, these are three important aspects that minimum punishment for rape was laid down. 7 years for ordinary rape and 10 years for aggravated rape, which is custodial rape, rape of minor under 12, pregnant women, various things happen. And then some mandatory minimum punishment. Custodial rape should be taken more seriously. The burden of proof would shift in custodial rape cases where the person who is accused has to prove he did not do it. Otherwise, in criminal law, it is the burden of proof is on the prosecution. In these cases, the burden of proof shifted to the accused. A new offense, that even if there is a sexual intercourse with consent, when a woman or child is in custody situation, this would also amount to sexual abuse. So these were three important shifts that came. And everybody was happy, the campaign was successful, etc. But if you see the next decade, at the end of the next decade, you realize that actually it had not made any impact at all. Why I'm saying it did not make any impact, the number of cases actually steadily went up. Number of convictions steadily came down. And it was more, getting more difficult to prove rape. And there was always a suspicion. She said yes. When she said yes, she means no. When she says no, she means yes. Various this kind of things started floating around. And men were all the time under the fear that we will be framed wrongly. There will be fraud committed on us, etc. So judges became more cautious. So this was the story of 1980 to 1990. In the meantime, there were other offenses concerning violence against women that came up. Particularly among them was the issue of dowry death. So there were a lot of women who were facing violence in their marital home, and either they were committing suicide or they were being burnt to death. So a new term came into our legal vocabulary called dowry death. And an amendment came to the Indian Penal Code 304B, which stated that if a woman dies under unnatural circumstances within 7 years of a marriage, then it would be an offense, and there was a demand for dowry, then it would be an offense under 304B, not murder, but 304B, where it is easier to prove the offense. We also got 498A around that time in 1983. This section was added to the IPC, where a woman's harassment for dowry or cruelty of any kind on her in a marital home would be an offense, and she can file a case and can arrest the family of the husband and his family members whoever were harassing her. So these were very important, the discourse changes from dowry and dowry related violence to also cruelty to women in their matrimonial home. Before this, there was a belief that there is no violence in the matrimonial home. Everybody treats this woman with a lot of love, care, and she became part of that family. Now, this issue brought out the kind of violence a young woman faces when she leaves her natal home and goes into her marital home. So this was 1983, 86, etc. There were a lot of these cases coming up. Alongside, there were also other issues that came up. One is the declining sex ratio. That somewhere a missing child, missing girl child syndrome that we call it, the number of girls per 1,000 males was steadily declining. I have these charts for all this, but I don't have them now. I could have shown it to you. How they were declining, the numbers were declining. And then when you probed further, how there are less girls born, or how more girls die between the age of 0 to 6, you come to the conclusion that we are a society with male preference, and girls are neglected, girls are unwanted, and also you find out through various DNA tests, etc., the sex of the child before the birth, and if it is a female child, you prefer to have an abortion. So this became a major campaign issue, while violence was perpetrated on women after they were born. The girl child was facing danger even before she was born because she's a girl. So this became a very major concern, embarrassment for the government, saying that, you know, internationally questions were raised that how girls are unwanted in India. So this campaign went on in up to 2010, 2020, and we continue to have a decline here. And a law was passed. Initially, 1988, it was passed in Maharashtra. 1994, it became a national law that you cannot do test of a pregnant woman and disclose the sex. You cannot do sex determination test of a pregnant woman. You cannot disclose, and you cannot do abortion only on the ground that she's carrying a female fetus. So this was another major issue of campaign. Alongside, there were two or three other issues. One was child trafficking, how women are trafficked, children are trafficked into prostitution, the prostitution rackets that are going on. And the other issue that was there was the Sati case in Devrala, in Rajasthan. A young 16 to 18 year old girl jumped into the funeral pyre, or was made to jump into the funeral pyre and immolate herself. And she died. She was very, very young. So there was another campaign to have a special law to prevent sati, which was a traditional custom. There was already a law. And here there was a need for reintroducing this law and giving it a very stringent punishment. Then there was trafficking case, as I told you. So 1980 to 1990, if you see, a lot of issues got highlighted and legislations were enacted to deal with this issue. In the next decade, there were even more issues that came up. And one important issue here was sexual harassment at workplace. This was originated with the Bauri Devi case in Rajasthan, where a woman of the lower caste was working on a government project against child marriage, and who had reported an incident of child marriage in the upper caste Thakur family, was raped by four or five men from this community. So this became a major issue. And actually, the case itself ended in acquittal, and a high court appeal to the high court is pending still. But meanwhile, some groups in Delhi took up this issue and took it to the Supreme Court, saying it is a responsibility of the government to ensure that when you are at workplace, you need to argue, you need to be protected, you need to be given a secure environment to work in, otherwise women will not be able to work. Secondly, the IPC section 354 is not sufficient, because you don't want to go through the rigor of a criminal law. But since this is a workplace situation, a civil law is needed, where the girl, a complaints committee should be there. A girl can go and meet her within her own office, the authorities, and explain to them that she's been harassed sexually. And they should create a harmonious work situation where women, harassing a woman at workplace becomes an offense. Or he's not a workplace ethics. So they have to have service rules accordingly, etc., etc. So this was not a legislation at that time. It was a judgment by Justice Verma in 1997 called Vishakha guidelines. You must have heard about Vishakha guidelines. And what the judge was doing was, by his judgment, he was usurping the legislative power of making rules and making laws. But he said very carefully that, I am passing this law until the government brings out a proper legislation. For the time being, I am doing this. So, though it was a violation of the separation of powers, it actually, the Supreme Court was holding up the government, saying that you're not passing laws, and hence we are consenting to take up this measure to the protection of women. Finally, in 2013, this law was passed, and it is applicable for the women in the organized sector as well as unorganized sector, and all workplaces, whether they are government or private, have to have these complaints committees after the 2013 amendment. And this is another avenue for women's protection, which makes it a better place for women to work in, so that there is a harmonious work environment that gets created through this. And it is mandatory to have awareness programs into all firms every year, so that the employees are aware that they are governed by this code of conduct. So these are some of the measures that came up. But alongside also, we had other procedural things. We got the institution of the family court. The act was passed in 1984. Rajasthan was one of the first courts to be instituted, but we got it in Bombay in 1989, Pune and Bombay. And now most states have family courts. There were also a lot of changes in the procedural law concerning rape. And in 2012, we also got a separate law to deal with child sexual offenses called POCSO Act, Protection of Children Against the Sexual Assault. So this was also very important development to treat child sexual abuse separately than adult sexual abuse. So this came in 2012. But with all this, the ground level situation did not improve. And then the Nirbhaya case happened, 2012, December 16, we all know about it. A very gruesome violation, sexual violation, gang rape that happened on the streets of Delhi. Mathura had happened in the rural areas. Not much was known about her, etc. But here we had when the TV channels, multimedia, etc. was there, so you could record many things. And also, it happened in Delhi, that in the capital city, and attracted a lot of world attention. And the government became very alert. There were a lot of morchas everywhere, in all the cities, not just in Delhi, and justice for Nirbhaya. In fact, Nirbhaya was a name given to her by the media. Her actual name is Jyoti Pandey. Anyway, so finally, conviction happened. The accused were sentenced to death, and a few months back, they were executed. So after this, after the Nirbhaya, again, we're back to the same situation. And our law, our rape law has envisaged mainly extreme cases like the Mathura case, the Suman Rani case, the Nirbhaya case, etc. But most of the rapes happen in domestic places, not by strangers, by acquaintances. There's somebody you know in your class, in your surroundings, in a neighbor, a teacher, a doctor, a religious person. I mean, the abuse happens at every level, particularly of children. And in children, now the burden of proof has shifted, and accused has to prove that he did not rape. But, and we have a very, our organization has a very vibrant program to support the victims and to help them to walk this legal journey. So we, from the time of FIR to the final trial stage, she needs a lot of support. She may have to leave her home. She might have to, the family might have to sell their residence and move to another area because of the stigma that is attached to rape. If the father is the rapist, then the breadwinner of the family has been incarcerated, and the family needs financial support, and there's a pressure on the girl to retract. There's constant pressure on the girl to retract once she files the case. So in order to protect her against all these pressures and pulls, we have a program in Majlis, which is a legal resource center, comprising of all women lawyers and support persons, to help such victims to walk the legal journey and to be of assistance at each time she requires help. This program we have started in 2011, and now it is about 7-8 years old. And we have also brought out a very detailed report of it. So now, what I want to say, all along our focus has been stringent law. That if there is a stringent law, if there is death penalty, then there will not be rape. It will act as a deterrent. Unfortunately, our conviction rate is very, very low. It's about 25%, 26%. So, and it drags on for years together. So the fear of the law is not there. And people think they can get away with it. So law has not had the desired effect on the ground of being a deterrent. And the procedures are long, procedures are cumbersome, the various kinds of pressures that operate on the girl herself. So either because of lack of evidence or because the girl retracts, acquittals happen. And when acquittals happen, there is a premise that is going on in society. These women have told lies, or girls have told lies, and the case didn't actually happen. Hello? Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Some noise.
Please. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So there is a premise that not that the prosecution did not prove the case, not that prosecution had been negligent about investigations, but it always the blame comes on girl that she had deposed falsely. So this is there very dominant in society, dominant in the legal fraternity. So now when we do this support program for these young girls, you can see definitely the conviction rate improves because the girl is confident when she goes to depose in the court. She's prepared for it. She knows what's going to happen. And she knows what she has stated in the FIR. So you have a different situation here where she's not nervous. She's protected from all kinds of pulls, etc. But this is a rare program which very few NGOs actually undertake because it is very cumbersome, long drawn. Each case might take 2 years to come up to the trial stage. Meanwhile, so many things may happen in a family life. So while we are focusing on bringing about laws, we are not focusing upon the procedures, the trauma of the procedures that is caused to the victim girl and how to help her to surmount it and be confident to attend the court trial. So this, according to me, is a great lacuna. On the other hand, we also had, apart from criminal law, the Domestic Violence Act. It came in 2005, where civil remedies were granted to women facing domestic violence, particularly injunction against throwing her out, particularly for her maintenance, child custody, compensation for injuries, etc. This was passed in 2005. With this, the jurisdiction was shifted from the district courts to the magistrate court at the local level. And special officers were appointed called protection officers to help this victim to reach the courts. And legal aid has been provided to carry the case further. So apparently on paper, everything looks very good. We have plugged all the loopholes and gaps. And we are in a comfortable situation. But unfortunately, our statistics on women do not prove so. Either it is in terms of the rape cases, cases of women dying in their matrimonial homes, issues of domestic violence, issues of rape. Now, if you see the statistics and look at the social status of women in our society, you will realize that although the laws are there, they're not reaching out to women who most need these laws. And hence, while there is a marginal improvement in literacy rates, etc., but a decline in employment in organized sector, increase in cases where women are subjected to violence. And overall, there is a kind of despair that nothing is going to change. Despite all our efforts, the things remain the same. But I just want to say things are not remain the same. If you are having this seminar, where so many other women are going to come and speak about different situation, she in the law, breaking the glass ceiling, the issues of media, etc. I am sure it's going to be a very interesting seminar and very timely. And I think students will benefit a great deal by such interventions. I'm sorry that I spoke too fast, maybe. And maybe all the issues you could not grapple. But if necessary, I can just highlight those issues and maybe send something to you all, which you can then recollect. Because I'm sure you have done in your class some of these issues, but some of these issues you may not have known. With this presentation, I hope it is more clear to you. Thank you very much. Hello.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for gracing the occasion as a chief guest. It was indeed a pleasure for us to listen to you. Long experience that you have told about the evolution and the chronological structure that you have talked about the evolution of different women's rights movement in India. And now we would request you, as this is a virtual conference, so we would not have token or we are to enlighten and to inaugurate the session. So please, through the words, inaugurate the conference for our different speakers of the different themes. And we would like to start by 3:45 for the first conference. First thing. Yes, ma'am.
Are we having question answer session now?
Yes, ma'am. If you wish, we can take questions from the participants. Yes, please.
Yeah.
If anyone wants to ask any question, please ask.
You can raise your hands and ask questions. If anybody has a question for Flavia, ma'am.
Flavia Parikh, ma'am, has a question. Yes, ma'am, please.
Thank you so much, Flavia, ma'am, for this detailed journey of the legal developments that you have shared. It's a very thorough, and once again, it's so informative and so detailed to know how the journey transpired. One thing that has stayed true to every legal development, ma'am, as a practitioner in the legal field also, that I have noticed, is that it has taken a very important case, very extreme and gruesome case, something extreme to happen before the need for introducing a protective law has come into picture. And this need stays till today. So my question, ma'am, is if there is something that can fix this, that instead of being reactive, if the legal system were to be proactive in its approach, what could that element be? I understand things can't change overnight, but it's a question that bothers me also as a practitioner. So I'm asking for your inputs here. What is that element that can bring the proactiveness?
You know, the legal procedure is long drawn. There's nothing sensational about it in the movies, for instance. And each case takes about 2-3 years. As against this, a campaign reacting to an extreme, gruesome case of violence gives you a high. You join that campaign, you sign memorandums, you submit it to the Prime Minister or Home Minister, etc. And a lot of people are ready to join such campaigns. But if you see, even as a lawyer or even if you're a non-lawyer, a support person for a victim of rape, it takes years of routine, mundane level of work. And it's not great legal arguments or something. You just to see that the girl goes through this procedure with the knowledge that she has some support that is invisible work. And nobody likes to do this invisible work at all. You want a sort of an instant gratification for your involvement that you did something, you did the campaign and it was successful and you go home. It cannot be at that level. If you say that we have to be very consistent and not wait for something great to happen, something terribly adverse to happen to women, a gruesome case, to bring a petition to the law commission or to the women and child department, etc. Now you can observe the court proceeding, court procedure in each and every case, like a dowry death or a rape trial, and then document exactly what happened in this case. Where are the gaps there? Where, how to plug these loopholes, etc. And bring out a report and with all facts and figures and dates, etc. And submit it. And then have a campaign around it that issues brought up in these reports must be addressed. That would have, according to me, a better impact to change, because you don't need to change the law. You need to change the procedure at the court level. And if you get support and if you are able to like bring together organizations, and then you can have a change, a culture, change in culture, change in the thinking, change in court environment over a period of time. But this has to be, work has to be very sustained, and this work has to be very comprehensive. It cannot be like one day I went to court and I saw this, and then you write an article, then article becomes a base. It cannot be. There has to be numbers. There has to be case details. There has to be dates to support. Now, if such thing can be done in each state, for instance, and all these reports could be combined, I'm sure it will and then a campaign around it, I'm sure it will have greater impact of changing the environment within court rules. Like we can see in our own work, so much has changed in the environment of the court just by bringing in small, small changes on an everyday level. But very few places such a thing happen. And according to me, that's the only way out from doing this kind of sensational work and bringing in the penalty or bringing in some harsh punishment to the accused. But the case may not reach that level where it comes to conviction. The case is over much before that. So what is your worth? What is the worth of your stringent punishment-oriented law?
I think Pallavi ma'am has another question. Yes, ma'am, please.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing your thoughts. On this sideline, I have another question regarding the language of the gender and the meaning of the gender, which is currently existing in the legal text so far. When we look at the definition or the understood definition of man and woman, somewhere it only limits itself to the binary nature of the gender and sex. So there are two ways that can go about it. One is to create a separate category of laws for trans men and trans women in the country right now. Or we can actually look at making these existing definition in the current laws, let's say women-related laws only, and include trans women in it. What are your thoughts on this one, ma'am?
I think your question is very apt and very well framed. And actually, trans women identify with the women's movement a lot. Trans men also identify with the women's movement to a great deal. So it would make sense to include trans people into laws specifically meant for women. So there was such a move when the rape law was to be amended, whether trans people can be included in the definition of women. But finally, that didn't happen. So bringing in separate law for trans people is a worthwhile exercise, because then you can bring in civil and criminal law. But with the rape, we are only looking at the criminal law. But till that thing happens, at least as by way of introduction, we can include in the definition about women that even trans people are included, particularly for 376, 354, etc. Because there, we have to admit there's a lot of sexual abuse that goes on by heterosexual people on trans people all the time. And even within trans communities, there is sexual abuse. So this needs to be addressed, and there is a very dire need for that. In fact, many of us in the women's movement were opposed to including trans people in the definition of women, because we thought that would dilute the entire issue. But now that we have gone further into our thinking, I feel that addressing that abuse that is going on for trans people, it would be simpler to include them within the existing law that is applied to women. And thank you very much for asking this question. I think it's important.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Have I answered your question?
Yes, ma'am. I have so many connected thoughts on it, but I know that other people are waiting, so I will look for the time and opportunity when I can dive deeper into this with you and pick your brains for you on this. But thank you so much. On the face front, yes, my question and doubt is answered. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So there is another question by Prasasti. So Prasasti, please ask your question by unmuting yourself.
Yes, thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you, Flavia ma'am. It is always a pleasure to listen to you. Actually, I want to ask a question regarding misuse of law by women. Ma'am, this is a sweeping statement which is being passed by layman to lawman. Everyone is taking the ground of NCRB data. In NCRB data, they are focusing the rate of arrest and the rate of conviction. Since there is a huge gap, and they are taking it as a ground of misuse. So what is your opinion on this, ma'am?
See, if we are referring to the cases filed under cruelty, 498 cases, for instance, there are so many pressures on the woman after she files the case. First and foremost, if you look around here, if you look at the UN studies, etc., comparing India to many other countries, you will see that violence against women or domestic violence or sexual abuse in India is far greater than other countries. There's a lot of sexual abuse. Then you look at the cases of either wife murder or you look at the cases of 498 cruelty. Yes. And you can see the cases are minuscule. I've done a study for Bombay. And in most cases, there are 92 police stations here in Bombay. And
yes, ma'am. That article was published in EPW.
Yeah, the cases are very minimal, like 2 or 3 per year. So there's not like a huge amount of cases that are filed. Now about the delay, I am a civil lawyer dealing with matrimonial issues. Now, after filing a case, if the woman also files for divorce, for instance, and the husband is coming forward for a settlement, his one condition is you withdraw your 498 case and then I'm agreeable for a divorce and I'm ready to sit for a negotiation table to decide about the alimony, lump sum maintenance, etc., etc. Now the woman is left with no choice except to withdraw the 498 case because her intention of filing the case is not to get this guy punished for 3 years or whatever. Her intention here is that she wants to move on in her life. She wants to end all this litigation. And she wants to start a life afresh. So when such an option is given to her, many women compromise. And they say, okay, I'm ready to withdraw the case. Now this becomes construed as a false case. So it is not the case is false. It is that situations make it imperative for her to withdraw this case. Now conviction in 498, particularly if you see the cases where the woman is alive, is absolutely nil. There's no conviction at all.
Yes.
Conviction that is there where the woman's died is a case where you this is filed under 302 or 304B, then it comes to 306, then finally 498A. So you get a punishment for 498A, which is the minimal punishment. These are the only convicted cases, and the other, and it's like watered down. Now, in such situations, we cannot hold that women are filing false cases. You have to see that women are not able to sustain the litigation, criminal litigation. And all the forces around her work on it that she has to compromise. So how can we, there are no shelters, and litigation is expensive, the family support is missing, there are lots of issues here. and the husband is ready to come to a compromise. She thinks it's more viable for her to enter into it. As a divorce lawyer, I know it for myself personally. The husband's first condition is withdraw for 90 days. And the courts also say, go and withdraw for 90 days and we'll settle the case. So what is this woman to do in such a situation? So she goes and withdraws the case. So it is not a false case that she was not beaten. It is a case that she had to do a compromise for her greater good to solve her life problems and not just the criminal law problems. Even in rape cases, it happens so much that if the father is raped, father is inside, mother is begging of the girl to retract, or the girl eloped, somebody took eloped with her, took her inducement into elopement. And now the family is getting married to somebody else. Now, first the family says, now we don't want this criminal case. We will withdraw this. We will compound this case. She goes to court and says, I filed a false case. So these are all the pressures that go on. It's not the demand for the drop of a hat, run to the police station to file a case. It takes a lot of effort to file a case in the first instance at all. And without evidence, police will not file it. So we cannot construe by this saying that it is a false case.
But yes, ma'am. But what about the Supreme Court judge, ma'am, when he says that it is the disgruntled wives which are filing?
What to do? Yeah, judges are also having the same mindset. What to do?
Yes,
they are not trial court judges who are seeing this on the ground level. And then there were some as high court judges and moved on to Supreme Court or direct recruitment, etc. Unless you are a magistrate, at the local level, with close proximity to the community and to the happenings, I feel the judges should be more responsible while making such sweeping statements about women.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And that is horrifying because every defense lawyer will quote these things. That this is what Supreme Court says. This is what Supreme Court says.
It is sabotaging the whole movement, ma'am.
Absolutely. Even the recent judgment about Hindu women's right to achieve a property, there also the judge says a woman is a girl is a daughter, a man is a son, a son is a son till he gets his wife.
Son till he gets wife.
And a wife, and the daughter is a daughter all her life. That is not the truth at all, because the daughter is married and sent away. To her in-law's house. She doesn't keep contact with her native family. It's not possible. And the son lives in the same house with the father. He brings in the wife. And to say that wife is a manipulator, taking the husband away from his own parents, is such a abusive kind of statement, and which is not true. The judges endorse.
Yes, ma'am.
You just show their understanding of gender equality and so follow.
I'm sorry to intervene.
Thank you,
Devlina, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Please proceed.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, hi.
Yeah.
Hi, ma'am. Firstly, it's such an honor to meet you. I'm Devlina and I'm a lawyer out here, and I've joined all of you from Hong Kong.
Where are you based?
I'm based in Hong Kong, ma'am. But I've studied so much about you when I was in law school. I'm a graduate of NUJS. And I never, ever thought that I would ever get to even meet you. So it's a momentous time for me, ma'am. You wouldn't understand what it means to just meet you. I have one question here, ma'am. I mean, POSCO is all good, right? It is the need of the hour, and, you know, it really helps protect our children. And, you know, we've broadened the definition of rape in POSCO and, you know, put the burden of proof on the accused, and everything is all good. But unfortunately, POSCO only protects children who were born on or after 1994, because any crime that was committed on a person, say if a sexual offense happened to a woman in the 1990s, you know, and the 1990s, as you would know, is a world where you didn't have Google, many of us didn't even know what was a good touch, what was bad touch, you know, so we really didn't have the information to call out on the abusers. Even our laws then, the best the best relief we would have, you know, in cases which could not be classified as rape as per the traditional definition, would maybe fall under Section 354, for which the highest term of imprisonment would be maybe 2 years. And thanks to the very limited definition of the limitation period associated with Section 354, you know, if you go through the relevant sections of the CRPC, it would mean that within 3 years of time, you had to bring forth the complaint. Now, that's a little absurd, because if you were born in the 1990s or early 80s, and you know, if the offense happened to you when you were say 6, 7, or even say when you were 14 years of age and you're not covered by POSCO, how does the law even expect you to file a case in 3 years of time when you're 17 years of age? I mean, that's of course ridiculous, you know. And even though all those offenses now under POSCO surely would come within the broader definition of rape, say for example rape by fingers or insertion of foreign objects, right? So that's one question to you. And I was wondering if there are any NGOs or what's happening in India to try and give some relief to women who would otherwise not be covered under POSCO, women who were born prior to, say, 1994, and who would have suffered perhaps. And these kind of offenses, ma'am, you know that it takes it takes decades for women to have the courage to come forward and speak. So is there any kind of thought or any kind of discussion or movement that is going out there, you know, any kind of action that is being taken to perhaps extend and broaden the ambit of POSCO, you know, because there shouldn't be any distinction. We are all citizens of India. There shouldn't be any distinction between anyone born after a certain period and before a certain period, especially if you've suffered the same crime, and in an era especially when you had little or no information to call out on your abusers. It's almost silencing a group of women of a particular era from bringing the perpetrators to justice, women who perhaps even till today could be suffering from the repercussion of what they suffered as a child. Any thoughts on that, ma'am? Sorry, ma'am, I don't see you right now.
Oh, I'm there very much. I can see you.
Yeah.
Okay, now, yeah, we have got cases of abuse that had happened to women when they were children, and they had not filed any complaint at that time. And sometimes the abuser has also dead and gone, but the trauma suffered by the victim is very, very stark, and she's not been able to come out of it. But in the criminal law, when an offense is committed, a law should be enforced. And the criminal or the accused person should know this is the law and is violating that law. Now, that situation is not there, because the POSCO came into effect only in December 2012. So any offense of a similar category which has not been addressed then cannot be brought into the legal arena now. But what, according to me, is important is to for the society to acknowledge, yes, that a crime has happened to someone, and in a way provide a situation for the survivor to cope with the trauma that she's still undergoing. There are one or two NGOs, I think, in Delhi and something, they are trying to deal with the situation through counseling and through other support structures. But criminally, there is no remedy at all. And I don't think there is any effort to bring in a law applicable retrospectively. Because criminal law cannot be applicable retrospectively. It has to be only prospective, that when a crime has been committed, the person should know the person is committing a crime. If you want to address sexual assault, you can argue that, yeah, always it is the person knows that this is an offense. It's not that he didn't know, but there's no legal remedy, so he cannot be booked. And unfortunately, if the offense is not recognized by law, even the society does not recognize it as offense. And hence, the remedial procedure becomes very, very limited. But I agree with you entirely that women suffer a lot of trauma. After many, like, decades, they come to you and say, this has happened. And till then, they have not spoken at all about it to anybody. And
absolutely.
We must provide at least certain measures where a healing process to the victim so that she's able to cope with the trauma and deal with it so that it gets minimized. But otherwise, it will get a burner and maybe driver to insanity. I've seen a lot of cases where the effects of this on males and females is really horrible. So we also feel very helpless when cases like this come to us, saying this, I want justice now. I want that person to be under this. Can I file a criminal case? Mm-hmm. We tell her, you can file a criminal case, but I wouldn't assure you that you will get justice. It'll create you a lot of trauma. And
But I think there should be some effort in kind of trying to garner a certain kind of momentum and interest, because what you're in effect doing is telling people born before 1994 that, hello, we've recognized what's happened to you as a crime in POSCO, but sorry, you were born before 1994. So your only remedy is 354 of the IPC. But again, sorry, you were 14 years old, 13 years old when the crime was committed, but you only had to, it's ridiculous expecting someone to make a 3-year limitation period applicable to crimes like that. How could you expect a child of 17, or for that matter, even if that person was 20, you know, by time he or she should have brought the case. 20 years, do you appear for your board exams, prepare for your career? You're totally dependent on your parents for financial assistance. How do you expect? Even adults don't have that kind of resources. Even lawyers, you know, law students don't have that kind of resources to come and fight for a case, have the connection. So I really think that there needs to be a lot more talk in this. And we just, because, you know, I have read judgments where the judges are, I do understand that criminal law cannot be retrospective. But at the same time, I think cases like this should not be strictly looked from the lens of limitation, clearly knowing that the trauma is ongoing, you know, and the nature of the crime that's taken place. So I think the only leeway we could have is perhaps, you know, maybe the punishment would still be 2 years under Section 354, but perhaps making sure that the limitation period is not so strictly interpreted by judges, and women are at least allowed to bring those cases to trial and nothing else. Yeah, but I really think, ma'am, we need to talk about it more. Mm. And I want to be in touch with you, maybe perhaps after this webinar. I promise I won't stalk you.
No, that's you know, okay. Like, they have my email.
Or like close your inbox.
It's just my name.
No, I don't, but I will source it. I will source it. I will source it from somewhere.
simplebabyagnes@gmail.com. My name and
okay, now 50 other people on the conference all know your email address. I'll definitely be in touch with you, because I want to
if it is something I can address, I will respond. If it is a frivolous question for which I don't have answer, then I don't
ask,
or I write back and say that I don't have an answer.
Of course,
so ma'am, we have a question from Gunia. Yes, Gunia, please, can you unmute yourself and ask?
Yeah, hi, am I audible?
Yes.
Hello, Flavia ma'am. I have been a huge fan. I can relate to what Ms. Saha was just saying. I have, my academic career began, I would just like to introduce myself. I'm a PhD scholar at JNU, and I did my thesis. My entire thesis actually started from reading your work back from the 1980s, 89, the Supreme Court judgments that you evaluated. And after that also, you worked on Supreme Court judgments in the 2000s. And the one thing, for 11 years, I've head on the entire restructuring of Indian rape laws, and even my PhD is revolving around the same question. But what one question that has always been with me, and even still is, I try to work on it in my MPhil, is that when the reports tell us that every 15 minutes there's a rape happening in India, then how is it that only a few rape cases come out in public? I mean, it was Mathura back then in 1983 when the open letter was written. And then recently in 2012, there was Nirbhaya, and more recently, Kathua and Unnao cases. Can we can we put it on media coverage that these cases get? How, as academicians, do we understand this? I really would like your input on that.
So what's your question, actually?
My question is that, as academicians, how do we understand that only a few rape cases come out in public and are taken up by as social movements or very thoroughly followed by the media? Only a few cases when there are 15, there are cases every 15 minutes. So why only a few cases are picked up by the media? Or how is it that we as individuals get to know about only a few handpicked cases from the media?
Actually, as academicians, according to me, something can be done about this. That is to get the police records from the police headquarters to see how many cases were actually filed, how many cases were charge sheeted. And then they have also certain categories of kind of rape, the relationship with the abuser, etc. And as activists, we gather this information, but we don't have the skills to bring out regular reports, to analyze them bring them to the public. We do have the information, but we don't have the skills to then further analyze it. We don't have the programs to analyze it. But that would be really a worthwhile. That's what I was trying to say. Even a few cases followed up very systematically can have an impact. But unfortunately, the media attention is drawn only on these most sensational cases, because the public also wants to watch only these most sensational cases. And nobody is interested in the day-to-day aspects of litigation. And that's the sad truth of it. What I have noticed is when we do positive interventions and call the media, nobody is interested in coming. But when they locate a gruesome, sensational case, they'll always ask me for my opinion. So that opinion, one or two sentences for them is good enough. And how much we ask them, come and see our program. Our programs are really worthwhile. It's an innovative program. It is a positive intervention. Nobody wants to look at it because the positive instances, positive interventions have no sensational value. So that is the sad thing. And then academicians like you who are interested in knowing do not give access to it. And activists like us, practicing lawyers, have this information, but we don't know where to channelize it. So there are these very glaring gaps, knowledge gaps that we are facing today. And somewhere we need to bridge this to have the perspective of activist lawyers to understand the case, to learn proper documentation and then bring it out in the open forum so that they can be addressed. You are absolutely right when we say, the number of cases that are there every day, many of them are by acquaintances. Some are very, very gruesome, in fact, no less gruesome than the Katwa rape or the Unnao case or Suman Rani and other rape cases. They are really gruesome cases. Young girls labeled as prostitutes, gang rape by men, police refusing to file cases. I have written out a few of them and I have it ready, but nobody wants to publish it also. That is the sad part. So that it becomes part of academic knowledge.